Hello, everyone. Good evening. How are we this evening? Are we good? You're in for a treat, let me tell you. But before we start, I would like first to acknowledge the traditional owners of the land on which we're having this event and respect the elders both past and present. I also would like to recognize all of the individuals who are making an ongoing effort to protect and promote Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander cultures so that we may have a lasting legacy for future elders and leaders. Now, let's get to it. Hey, you like my outfit this evening? Yeah? Yeah, yeah. It took me 10 minutes to put this together because I am male, after all. My name is Guri, and I'm from the School of Biological Sciences at UQ, and it is my privilege to be your host this evening. Now, how many of you are here for the first time? Very good. And so the rest of you would know that I am not your regular host. Well, I was a bit disappointed, to be honest, when I was told to do this gig because your regular host, Joel Gilmore. I thought I was here to roast Joel Gilmore, but it turns out I'm here to host Joel Gilmore. So Joel, you've really dodged a bullet there, Joel. Now, you are in for a treat. And before I tell you a bit about our speakers this evening, some of you might have gotten a white slip of paper as you walked in this evening. And that slip of paper is basically for you to pen down your thoughts, if any, throughout the evening and put down some questions that you might like to ask our speakers later on. We have some time for some question and answer. If you don't have that slip of paper, you can log on to your smartphones on Twitter and use the hashtag BrisScience, that's BrisScience, hashtag BrisScience, and I'll have a look at your questions at that stage, okay? Now, if you do require the bathrooms, of course, it's gonna really, be so engaging you wouldn't wanna go, but if you really do require the bathrooms, they're located conveniently just outside, down one flight of staircase, or you can go right through, and your first right is where you'll find the bathrooms. Now, all of you guys have the best seats in the house, but for those of you towards the back and at the sides, please do not worry because we have a camera above. And you'll be able to see everything that's gonna go on right down here, okay? So everybody's gonna really, really enjoy themselves. Now let me tell you a bit more about our speakers this evening. We have not one, but two speakers, two for one at a free event with free food. Sorry, I was just channeling the inner Asian in me. Our very first speaker, you might have seen him on TV in Ben's Food Lab. He is a celebrity chef and he is none other than Ben Milbourne. Ben Milbourne was also a contestant and finalist in MasterChef Australia. But before all of that, he was studying applied science and graduated with applied science from UQ and then started to teach at high school. And it was his students that motivated him and nominated him to join that competition. So we have Ben Milbourne this evening. Would you join me in a round of applause? We also have Dr. Joel Gilmore. Now, Joel finished his PhD in physics in 2007, also at the University of Queensland. So for all of you youngsters, UQ will take you places, okay? Now, Joel finished his PhD from UQ in 2007. That was in physics. He then proceeded to do some science communication. And these days, he's working as an energy consultant and helping us transition to a low emissions energy future right here in Australia. So we have Joel this evening. And there is a few things about Joel I'm obligated to tell you. Joel is also a molecular gastronomist. He loves cooking, okay? And he's going to show you this evening how he's going to apply his background in physics to understand the way we cook our food. And apparently, in his spare time, he likes swing dancing. So tonight, along with a spread of food, we're going to have entertainment. Joel is very well-traveled, and Joel is also does a lot of stand-up comedy. Joel, apparently people find you funny, Joel. And Joel unicycles to work. How cool is that? Okay, are you all ready? Because I sure am. So I'm here to test the food. Yeah. Okay. Well, if you're ready, I'm ready. Ladies and gentlemen, would you please join me in giving a warm welcome to celebrity chef Ben Milbourne and my good friend Joel Gilmore.
Thank you.
Thank you. And a big thank you to Gurian for his very last BrisScience hosting night.
You did very well. I think you're in trouble, mate. He did very well. Mm. Normally, I don't know whether anyone knows anything about my background. I'm normally on a stage with a guy named Andy Allen, and I'm normally the smartest person on stage. For the first time, I'm actually not going to be the smartest person on stage.
Nothing's changed, Ben.
So tonight, we're going to look at food and science. I'm going to take care of the food component, and Joel will explain the science that's going on. But we use science in our restaurant kitchen all the time, and lots of restaurant kitchens all over the country, to make our lives easier. We've adapted these scientific principles, techniques, additives to our dishes to try and make our life in the kitchen a lot easier. So I'm going to show you how they make your life easier, and Joel will teach you how they make your life easier.
Because as part of this is that we have a long history of trying to understand things, and that ranges from electricity, which results in computers and technology, but through to understanding how food works. And because we understand how things cook or gel or whatever, we've been able to apply more and more technology to create better versions of those things. And that's what I love about this setup here is we are using a mix of traditional cooking techniques, done very well, and new technology to make it done even easier.
And food is on a constant evolution. We're always trying to tweak things and change things, but the basics always apply. So we still add heat to food to create different chemical reactions, to try and bring different flavours out, to try and tweak things, but we're on this constant evolution with food. Now, some people might say that we've gone too far and food should just be tasty and there's nothing wrong with a really, really simple dish that you cook at home for breakfast. And that's absolutely 100% true. You should only ever add or incorporate science if it makes the food better. And that's what I'm going to try and show you, how we're trying to make food better, but we're also, from a chef's point of view, a kitchen is a really stressful environment. If you've watched any of the TV shows that are on, it is really stressful. Not as stressful as the TV shows make it look, I do promise you that, but it is very stressful. You add 12 cameras to that and it gets even more stressful. But we're trying to take as much stress out as possible, and there are certain things that can help us do that. So I'm going to get started on one that we use in our kitchen all the time. There are constantly compressed foods in our fridges, in our bains, in our water baths, in the kitchen all the time. So cryovac machines, they're everywhere now. I think that you can probably tell, you know, you've got the scientist on this side and you've got obviously the...
I feel like I've been shortchanged in the cool things department.
The really quite anal chef on this side. Who needs all the extra little things he can grab to try and make, to fulfill his ego a little bit. So I'm going to put things into this bag. Now it's a food safe bag. It can stand up to a really high temperature. We're not going to take it up to a temperature, but it can do that. And we're going to take the atmosphere out of it. And Joel will explain to you why that's important, but I like it because it gives me a better flavour. And I'll tell you a really simple way of understanding that. I used to walk into my grandmother's house and she used to make pumpkin soup. And I could smell the pumpkin soup from the moment I got out of the car. I knew she was making pumpkin soup. And I'd walk in and I could smell it was beautiful. But if you think, if pumpkin soup has 100 units of flavour and I can smell it in the air, you've lost a lot of those units of flavour to the atmosphere. It's no longer in the food where it should be. So in taking the atmosphere away, I can keep flavour where it belongs, in the thing you're going to eat. And I can also incorporate other flavours into it because they have nowhere to go but into the thing you'll put in your mouth. So you'll notice I'm going to make a berry compote flavoured with vanilla and star anise, and you won't be able to smell it at all. We won't be able to smell it up here until I cut the bag open and you eat it. So all that flavour is still there. Joel, how does that actually work? I imagine particle... Theory has a role in that while I do some work?
I mean, and as you say, there's a bunch of things that are going on here. And there's nothing that Ben's doing that can't be done, you know, in traditional ways, in a bowl or in the fridge or whatever. But by removing the atmosphere, a few things happen. Firstly, as Ben said, we are sealing everything in a bag. So we are trapping all of those flavour molecules and compounds. It also has the effect of removing oxygen from the bag, and depending on what you're doing, that can have a role. So one thing we often do sealed in bags, sous vide, under vacuum, is steak. And one thing you'll notice, if you cook a steak under vacuum and then open it out and cut it open, that steak looks almost grey in the middle. And that's because the oxygen hasn't had a time, had an opportunity to bind with the hemoglobin inside the steak, which gives it that lovely pink colour. Now, whether or not that matters for your particular dish depends a lot on what you're actually doing. In this case, I'm not sure how significant it really is for berries, but it is part of it. The other big thing that's going on is that Ben is going to add, I assume, some sugar into the bag, along with these flavour molecules. And what that's going to mean is that we are going to, by compressing the bag, we're going to get a really good contact between the sugar and the fruit. And there's going to be no air in there getting in the way of that. And this can help to speed up the osmosis of water being drawn out of those fruits to go into the sugar. So this is basically that you've got lots of sugar on one side of the fruit, comparatively less sugar on the other side, which means that along those lines, you want to balance that out. And so it's hard for sugar to go into the fruit, much easier for water to go out of the fruit and to balance out the concentrations. So this will draw the water and flavour molecules out of the fruit to create a lovely sauce that is well flavoured.
So the planet likes to exist in equilibrium. So that's, I guess, what osmosis is, isn't it? It's trying to balance out whatever concentrations there are on the outside as to the concentrations on the inside. And salt will work the same way. That's how we preserve foods.
Yep.
If you're salting a piece of salmon or salting a piece of meat, you're putting salt on the outside. There's no moisture on the outside. The moisture will move to try and balance out that salt. Once you get your water levels to a low enough level, bacteria can't grow. So you won't get any of the bad bacteria forming, and you preserve foods. So it's not like it's a new technique. It's just we're trying to advance. So normally I do this with pickling as well. So I'll get carrots, anything that I want to pickle. And if I put my pickling stock in there, I can get that pickle to happen in 2 hours instead of having to leave it for 2 weeks to get the complete pickle. Right, so in here, we have...
You're seeing my best side.
We have our blackberries, we have our star anise, our vanilla, and some sugar.
Release the dramatic tension there.
And then it just seals it up. So we've now got, and it's sometimes called compressed fruit if you see it on a menu. We do it with watermelon a little bit as well. So you put watermelon, a lot of people put vodka in there and then seal it up and you get compressed fruit and the vodka goes inside the fruit so you eat the...
And you would, in the restaurant, you use a like a chamber vacuum, right? That gives you much higher pressures.
Much higher pressures. So it actually works in reverse, so all the atmosphere goes in and then it sucks all the atmosphere back out. So it's a much more... But that's still... I mean, there's nothing really left in there. So it's still a good way to do it at home. These, as I said, the vacuum seal bags or the vacuum seal machines are everywhere now. Sunbeam released one a little while last year and it won Best Domestic New Domestic Product in Australia, I think. So they are prevalent. You can get them everywhere. And they're a good way, even if you've got... Tomatoes, compressed tomatoes, some olive oil, basil, salt, pepper, tomatoes, put it in there, seal it up, and it makes this beautiful little tomato compote, which is ends up, if you can just strain it into a sieve, it ends up with a really clear liquid that comes out, which is quite nice. So I'm just going to let that sit there, and we'll surprisingly get more and more and more of the juice that comes out. So we've got a little coolie to play with a little bit later when we do something.
And if Ben wanted to speed this up further... Now that it's sealed up in this bag, not only is it sealed to air, but it's sealed to water. So he could put that into a sous vide bath and heat it up. And at a low temperature, that would accelerate the rate that this infusion happens. This is great for making infused oils or infused alcohols because everything is trapped in there. Normally heating, as Ben said, will lose those things. Unfortunately, Qantas issued Ben a special MasterChef challenge.
It's quite a red letter day for Qantas. I can't do it because on the trip up here, obviously the fragile sign that was on my bag, Qantas completely ignored and just threw my bag everywhere and smashed my thermocirculator. So normally you would fill water in here. This goes on there, you set the temperature, and then it will just circulate water at the specific temperature that you set it at. Now, Joel was talking about having steaks sous vide, cryovac sealed up and sous vide. This is how we would do a steak in the restaurant. So we would have we have smaller bars like this one. That's another thing when you're traveling around and you do these kind of things. You travel with a lot of white powder.
Could you tell me what this white powder is? Ensorbid M. Can you come with me, please, sir?
Yeah. I promise, I'm a chef. I need it. So that's always fun, traveling around the country with little containers of white powder. So steaks, we would have the little ones set up. We would have that set in five-degree increments. So you've got medium rare, medium well done, blue, all the way through. When an order comes in, we grab a bag out, which has got a steak in it. We cut it open. Fry pan, film of hot oil, pan sear it a minute each side to get that caramelization, and then a perfect steak goes out to the dining room, cooked spot on to the exact temperature that we want it cooked at. It makes life a lot less stressful in the kitchen when orders come in. So that's how we use science to make our lives a little bit easier in the kitchen.
And to put junior chefs out of work.
Yeah, real chefs. Chefs that have skill and talent. So that's that component of it. I'm going to use this a little bit later to create a thing called a fluid gel, which again, if you've watched any of the shows on television at the moment, it's one of those new things that you'll see on a menu, a fluid gel. I'll explain what a fluid gel is a little bit later, but thickening is the other thing that we do in restaurants all the time. Whether you're thickening a sauce, you're trying to thicken a stock, a soup, a coulis, anything like that. And most people would have heard of corn flour as a way to thicken something using a starch. So Joel will go through the process of thickening with corn flour, yep. The old school way of doing it.
Right. So this is, as in, thickening is something that we often want to do, whether it's gravies or with custards and everything. And cornstarch is the traditional way of doing that, one of many. So this is a starch, and everybody will have seen corn flour before. I am going to put a couple of spoonfuls of corn flour in here. What corn flour, and so I'm going to sort of take you through the steps of understanding a process, and Ben will talk through some aspects of that as well. So corn flour is a starch, and that means it is effectively a long series of sugars in a chain. There are different types of starch. There's amylose, which is fairly long linear chains. There's amylopectin, which is more of a branched network of starch. And each of these starches has different properties, which is why you can buy corn flour or potato starch or arrowroot.
Rice flour.
Yep. And all of them will do different things.
So we in the kitchen, we would normally, this is the base you would use to make a roux. So if you're going to thicken a sauce, you make a roux, which is normally plain flour or corn flour mixed with butter or milk or something that's got some flavour instead of water.
And why do you mix it with why do you mix it with butter?
Because I'm a chef and that's what we do.
And this, we've got a bit of a shtick going on here. And this is the idea of we're trying to understand. Because, of course, this is what chefs do, is you make the roux. And this is if you go to chef school, if there's such a thing. you learn. And for me as a kid, I found this incredibly frustrating. Kid, I mean, 20-something-year-old. That, you would make roux, like, why? Why do I do that? And part of the answer is that...
The basis of all good science. Why?
Yeah, right. And in this case, it's because starch granules are, I mentioned these long molecules. When you have a starch granule, and actually let's just pull up my computer for a second. If we could switch from camera. Oh, how convenient. This is a scanning electron microscope view of starch granules, zoomed in 1,000 something times. 10, that little TIE fighter shape on the left there, that's 10 micrometers, 10 bits of a meter, 10,000ths of a meter.
Zoomed in lots.
Yeah.
Zoomed in lots.
So you have these tiny little grains of starch that have been kind of wrapped up and form these crystals almost. And these crystals have a tendency to stick to one another if you get them hot or if you get them sufficiently hydrated. Now, if I just add some water here, Thank you, camera guy. You can probably see that we have now our lovely milky white solution. It is well dissolved. It looks like it's well dissolved, but it's actually not. This is a suspension. If I leave this, the corn flour will float to the bottom, because these granules, at the moment, don't absorb water very well. What we would have to do is to heat it.
So another place you probably would have been told to use starch, and may not have known it, when we were travelling through Italy, the one thing we got told by every Italian chef that we ever met was put a little bit of the pasta water into the sauce that you're making. Because the starch that comes out of the pasta as you cook it is in the water, you put it in, you heat it up, it will help thicken your sauce. So that's why you're told to add a little bit of pasta water to help emulsify. Is it emulsify? It wouldn't really be an emulsification, would it? It's more of a thickening.
There are elements of it. The starch does have some emulsifying properties, so particularly with that pasta, combining the oil and the water in your pasta sauce.
So we would always add a little bit of that pasta water and then shake it, and then the sauce would thicken a little bit around the pasta.
Now, what I'm going to do here, I'm going to turn that off for a sec. So I've heated this up. It's now about 50 degrees. I have my little infrared thermometer here.
That's very cool.
Alive, yes. Now this, you can see, heated to 50 degrees is still liquid. But what is about to start happening, if we switch back to that screen again, what is about to start happening is by heating it up, I'm going to disrupt the chains on the outside of the starch. And those chains are going to start to disrupt, and then they are going to start to entangle with themselves. Like a set of Christmas lights put in a box, shake the box around enough, or even lift it up and move it 5 centimetres.
Yeah, don't even shake it. Just put them in there, wait 5 seconds.
Right. Those lights immediately tangle with their neighbour, never ever to be undone. Except in starch you can. But the idea is that the outside is going to start to gelatinize first. And so now you see the first part of the answer, you have to trust me a little bit, is why we dissolved this starch in water first, in cold water, or why we cook it in butter, because we need to separate these individual granules you can see here from their neighbour. Otherwise, if you put this into hot water, the second it touched, the outside of those granules would instantly start to gel, and they'd instantly stick. See how close these granules are to their neighbour. But by dissolving it in water first and mixing around, or by mixing it into oil that separates them out without starting this dissolving process, they stay separate. And this is why you always see in the recipes, take two tablespoons of your cold liquid, dissolve your cornstarch into that, and then add it to the hot liquid, because you need to separate them.
So that should, in theory, stop that clumping that you get when you're adding corn flour.
Right. And anybody, I don't know if you can see well enough here, but you might just be able to see this has already started to separate out. You can start to see sort of little rivers there. But I'm going to heat the crap out of this now, because I don't care about having a nice... course. Now, if you heat too quickly, as a general rule, you're going to start to get clumps.
Yeah, you will do. You're not allowing enough of those bonds to break to let enough moisture in to get a nice smooth... thickening sauce.
You're risking having one spot heat too quickly, too much, and those clump together. So what's happening now is you might just start to see this getting a little bit thicker. Let's see where we're at temperature-wise. So it's 66 now. Cornstarch first starts at about 60 degrees. That's where this process starts. It's gone now, but that process starts to happen. Don't need to go back. And up to about 80 degrees, it gets more and more. And now you can see this sauce is starting to thicken. Because, if we go back to the other screen, what's happened now is we've moved on. Now the outside has done this. These pictures are from Harold McGee's On Food and Cooking, the only cookbook a scientist ever needs. as long as you've got 50 years to recreate each recipe from scratch. So these granules are now, the outside disrupted, and now they're letting water in, and they're starting to dissolve and swell. And what's happening now is those granules have swollen so much, it's like, those water crystals you put in plants? And they're normally very runny, you add some water, they swell up, and they thicken. And that's what we're seeing here. And then The final step is that they they explode and they start to leak some of this starch into the rest of the liquid and form a giant fishnet mesh that traps these large granules even more to make it as thick as possible. Here you can see some fantastic, from a 2006 paper, fantastic pictures showing as you heat up this temperature, 40, 50, no difference, 55, starting to swell a little bit, 60, oh God, what's going on, 70, they're huge, 80, it's this giant clumped mesh.
So that's, it's one of those questions, I guess, what came first, the chicken or the egg? Do you reckon chefs just, that naturally started happening, we started using it in our day-to-day cooking, or did someone figure out that that's how starch works and then we started using it more in our cooking?
I mean, I have to think it's the former,
yeah,
given that how long food and cooking has been around, but I don't know. The problem with this, of course, is that this is mildly unappetizing. I think I would have failed the MasterChef challenge. So it's very thick. It's also gone faintly snot-like. Because of the concentration I've used for the purposes of demos. It's also not very translucent. It's somewhat opaque. It's white, so it adds a colour. And I've had to heat it. But Ben...
Yeah, it's not overly appetising, is it?
Yeah, there you go. MasterChef shit fails me. But Ben has a better way.
So basically, we'll go through the same process that Joel went through with our syrup here. But I don't want to heat it. I've worked really hard to try and not add heat to this, to try and keep the flavours as blackberry, vanilla, star anise as I possibly can. And as you heat things, you change the flavour of them. So I don't want to heat this up. So I want to use a swelling agent that is a cold water swelling agent that I don't need to get up to 80 degrees to thicken what it is that I'm making. Now, in the past, we used a thing called agar-agar, which you would have to dissolve. You have to heat it a little bit to dissolve it. It would then set. Then you put it in a thermo mix or a stick blender and blitz it and you end up with a nice sort of smooth fluid gel. There's now an ingredient you can get which is called Ultratex, which doesn't sound like an ingredient, but basically Ultratex is a starch.
Yep.
But it's been a little bit more processed than say your corn flour starch has been processed.
And we actually don't know how this is made because it's proprietary, but the basic idea is you do this and then you dry it really quickly. You spray it, air dry it out, and you particleize it. And what you get, actually, if we go back to my slides for a sec. I missed this one. This is cool. This is the starch granule with image. Again, a scanning electron microscope image of a starch granule with its mesh. And this is what happens if you cook it too long. It leaks out too much and it deflates like a balloon and then your sauce goes runny again.
I love science. I'm a scientist. But if I bought a cookbook and they were the pictures in my cookbook, I would feel ripped off.
To be fair, if I went to my restaurant, I'd also feel ripped off. I cook. This is another more recent paper showing a whole bunch of modified starches. And this is where we've taken something like this. I think this Ultratex 4 is actually
Ultratex
made 4. From cornstarch. So it's actually this stuff.
Yeah.
But they have dried it and modified it in different acids and different ways. And we can now zoom in and see exactly what sort of molecule we've ended up with. And you can then test them out and test their solubility and viscosity and all these different things for different ways of treating it. And eventually, they've stumbled on this stuff. And it's absolutely brilliant.
So we'll... as I said to you before, that'll be the last thing that I do is make that fluid gel so that I'm trapping as much flavour in there as I possibly
Sounds
can.
Sounds ominous, Ben. The last thing I'll do.
But what I want to do between sort of now and the last thing I do is make a white chocolate and lime snow or soil. So the first thing I need to create this is I want to make an olive oil and chocolate ganache. So double boiler. A little bit of water. Turn that on. Pot on top. And then some white chocolate. And I'm going to use a lime-flavoured olive oil. And you don't have to use the olive oil if you don't want to. I just love the flavour that this actually gives it. Does everyone remember Splice ice creams? It was sort of that pine lime on the outside and the vanilla on the inside. This tastes and smells like splice. So I just love lime and white chocolate. I reckon it's a great combination. And I'm going to use passion fruit a little bit later. So lime, passion fruit, white chocolate just sort of works in my head. You could just use olive oil or you could just use white chocolate and make a ganache. White chocolate is a little bit temperamental. So adding something to it to help stabilize it like oil to make your ganaches is a good idea. Now, if I wanted to, once I make this ganache, I could whip up some cream to a soft peak. I could get some egg whites and take them to marshmallow. So whisk them to a soft peak, rain some sugar into a stiff peak, and then fold the ganache, the cream, and the marshmallow together, and it would create a beautiful mousse. And that's just absolutely fantastic. But for the purpose of what we're going to do here, I want to turn it into a little snow. So the ingredient I'm going to use, again, doesn't sound like an ingredient. It's called maltodextrin. So if you don't think you've eaten maltodextrin before, I guarantee you have. If you've eaten a cheesel or a CC or a twisty and that yellow stuff that you get on your fingers, that's maltodextrin and cheese mixed together. So just like, and Joel will explain a little bit more about the properties of maltodextrin, but it's how I would use Ultratex on a liquid. I use maltodextrin the same way on a high fat soluble ingredient. So I've done this with peanut butter, Nutella, and made peanut butter and white and Nutella soil, mix them together, and you just eat it by the spoonful, which isn't great. The good thing is this is a bulking agent of about 4 to 1. So you get about 4 times what you started with. So you just measure out your calories, and then you can eat 4 times that. And this is our maltodextrin here. So this is what I always have problems traveling around the country with. It is super light. It's inzorbit maltodextrin. So it is a really fine, beautifully processed version of maltodextrin. I reckon the residual heat in there is going to do everything I need it to do.
And this maltodextrin is a starch as well. It's actually a starch, a modified starch, in the sense that you have to prepare that starch in a certain way, and it produces this maltodextrin molecule. This one's derived from tapioca. And what it is much shorter chains of starch, and in this particular variety, two very special properties. One is the starch molecule is wrapped up into a helix shape, and it has hydrophilic and hydrophobic components to that. So hydrophilic means that there's an end of the molecule that loves water but hates oil, and hydrophobic means there is an end that loves oil and hates water. Obviously, I'm speaking in analogies because, it doesn't actually love or hate or anything like that. Analogies are in science are a little bit like the sequels to the Matrix movie. Not very good. Or they're a little bit like Tiger Air. You know, it's useful, you just don't want to rely on them. Sorry, Tiger. Just kidding, you're great. I love your discount fares. So one property, what that means is the inside of this spiral, it turns out, has the hydrophobic ends, the ends that love oil. And so when Ben mixes this powder in, that oil is going to be drawn into the centre of that helix. The other thing is, as Ben already mentioned, is this stuff is insanely light. Well, not insanely light, it's insanely low density. And that means that the individual granules of starch are really dispersed. Relatively speaking, which means the oil doesn't have an opportunity to clump with its neighbour. And so this is able to produce some really interesting textures. And I'll let Ben sort of get into his demonstration here.
So, as Joel said, it's super light. When you order it, you order it online and you order like 180 grams of it, and it turns up at your house in a tub this big.
The website actually has warnings, like, warning, this comes in a really large box. I kid you not. They just kind of get you on the same page.
So it's about 4 to 1 if you're looking at ratios of how much to add.
Do you want to zoom in just a little bit more while Ben's doing this?
So this will start to dissolve into that white chocolate ganache. And I want to, there's two options here. I just hope I haven't added too much. You can get to a point, which we're at now. Thank you, mate. where it'll start to almost form like a Play-Doh, which is, it's about there. And it becomes this really malleable sort of Play-Doh. I don't know any other way to explain it. I have kids and this is what their Play-Doh feels like. So you end up with this really malleable, soft dough. Now, if I put that into a fry pan and just rolled it back and forward in the fry pan, the heat would start to melt the outside and it would form this little shell, and then the inside would melt. And if I pop it in my mouth, the shell would break and it'd be like an egg yolk just oozing into your mouth. It's divine. Joel, just try a little bit of that dough.
Now, here's the magic. At the moment, this liquid now looks very dry. You can see, as Ben's demonstrating, it feels very dry. I pop this in my mouth.
So freaking good.
That's good, isn't it?
That is so good.
That's good.
What's brilliant about this? Actually, I think I need to practice that again. I just need to check my... Science is really important to repeat your experiments.
Now, what's important thing is... all the heckin'
melts at around about 37 degrees. So add a little bit of moisture, like your tongue, a little bit of heat, like your tongue. Yep, there you go, 36. It will melt this powder back into a liquid. So as I put this in my mouth, it is literally dissolving instantly on my tongue back into this beautiful texture, beautiful flavour of oil. And so now, when I put it to my mouth, I really can't smell it at all.
So that ganache that we started with, when Joel puts that little Play-Doh into his mouth, it goes back into that ganache. And it's just this really clean, beautiful flavour that you get. So, well, if I keep taking it further, I'll go past that little sort of Play-Doh-y malleable stage and we'll end up with the snow or the gravel or the sand that you sort of, you want for your dish. And again, it's one of those things that you might see on restaurant menus if you're going out to restaurants where this sort of technique is being used. And you're getting flavours that you think, well, how is that? How is something that's this white powder, how does it have all that flavour? Now, oil is, or fat is a really high carrier of flavour. That's why we mix things, you've got truffles or something that's really expensive. It always goes with something that's really high in fat. So it carries that flavour. You get more out of a smaller ingredient.
There's also a hydrophobic, hydrophilic connection here, which is why alcohol also is a great carrier of flavour.
Gin.
Why does everyone laugh at that? You know, when you think about what's a liquid you can get that has the most flavours, alcohol's got to be top of your list. Like even vanilla essence is 50% alcohol. Yes, you can buy 50% alcohol at Coles. Just saying, kids.
I was about to say, is that information we should be giving out?
I've never been particularly good at that. You know, knowledge should be free, right? This is, you know, a key part of cooking is encapsulating flavours.
So then you end up with this, which is this beautiful white powder, which can go on top of a dish. And it feels like sand or soil. And you put it on top of a dish. It looks like there's a lot there. When it goes into your mouth, it just sort of fades away and you end up with this beautiful olive oil, lime and white chocolate flavour. So that's another little additive that we're going to use to plate up our dish at the end. So I'll pop that over there. We're about there with sort of this little ball of gooey goodness. Do you want to eat it or should we? Can we give it to someone?
And give it to the audience. Anyone but Gurion.
Your partner can have some, but not you.
That's going to be so good. All right. So I'll turn that off. You can decide who eats that, Joel.
Do we have a victor? Sorry, volunteer. I think the lady in the front there had her hand up first. Would you like to join us around the side of the stage? Give her a huge round of applause for being so brave. Now, do you have any tasting notes here for her, Ben?
Just eat it and enjoy it. Now, it might be a little bit warm, obviously, so Just.
It's all right. Ben's careful. Got great insurance.
As a chef, that reaction, you have no idea how much that means to me. Like, chefs, we're all unloved as children, and that's what we crave. That exact reaction. That's it.
Your round of applause. Ben Milbourne, ladies and gentlemen.
So something really, really simple. It's science helping us create. If you do this at your home in a dinner party, people will think you're, you know, one of the best chefs going around. But it's all you did was mix a powder with some white chocolate. Don't tell them that. Tell them it was really, really difficult and you spent ages doing it. I'm demystifying some of our chef secrets. But it really is as simple as that. So that's another component we're going to use. The last thing I'm going to play around with is lecithin, which you've got eggs there.
Mm, oh, yes, yes. So, Ben, you want to make a foam.
I'm trying to make a stable foam.
Okay, so this is a fun little game for the budding scientist. Egg whites. What happens if I beat an egg white? Air? Yes, so I am incorporating air. What else? It gets fluffy. Thank you. Somebody who gets to the heart of things. It gets fluffy. It gets foamy. Now, there's a bunch of things that are going on here, but one of the key things is that by beating the egg white, I am incorporating air, but I am also bashing around the molecules in here. And I am producing this lovely foam. I'm not going to go all the way. Now, obviously, if I beat up water, this doesn't happen. But what I'm doing here is I'm creating these bubbles of air, and they get surrounded by proteins. And what happens is these proteins have hydrophobic ends and hydrophilic ends, and the phobic ends want to get into the air, and the philic ends want to get into the water and away from the air. And so it forms these wonderful shells around each bubble and help make those bubbles stable. Oh, my God. Now, what happens if I beat egg yolks? Thank you. You missed your chance there. You could have had a winner again. It doesn't go fluffy. If I beat these yolks, there is a qualitative difference between these two, right? Why doesn't the egg yolk go fluffy? He's good. Somebody give me the obvious answer as to why the egg yolk doesn't go foamy.
There's no lecithin in a jar.
Thank you, Ben. But you're wrong. In fact, there is much more lecithin, I think, in the yolk than in the white. The only reason the egg yolk doesn't go fluffy is actually not enough liquid. If I add some more liquid, like this, that's probably way too much, but never mind. Oh, look what happens. We're starting to get bubbles and foam.
So what else do we generally use lecithin for, especially when we're looking at egg yolks?
So this is sort of demonstrating that both the white and the yolk have this magic molecule. And this is basically anywhere that you want to combine water with something that does not dissolve in water. So here you want to have water and air in a lovely foam, lecithin. If you want to make a mayonnaise, combine oil and water, you want lecithin. So egg yolks in your mayonnaise. This is sort of instant vegan egg yolks.
Yeah, so this is powdered lecithin, really. And you can get an egg-based lecithin, an egg powder, but this is made from soy. So it's a soy lecithin. So it is it's a way of getting around the whole vegan thing. But it also gives you the stability that Joel was talking about in creating foams. So normally with things, if I want to create a foam, the problem I have is I'll get the foam, but if I don't have lecithin in it, it'll just collapse. Once I stop whisking, it'll collapse. This means it will hold up.
And I should actually qualify that with the egg yolks. Whites can be quite stable on their own if you beat them enough. The yolks, you do need to add a little bit of heat to really stabilise them for a variety of reasons. And that's the sabayon, the French egg dessert. So this is how you make that. You add orange juice or champagne or whatever to your egg yolks.
Champagne. You do a lot of talking about alcohol, Joel.
What can I say? It's important to have your priorities right.
So in there. If I keep blitzing that, I'll end up with the foam will basically build on itself, and we'll end up with the foam. But that's one way you can do it. So this is passion fruit pulp. Our soy lesser than granules went in. I blitzed. If I keep blitzing and getting enough air in it, so I tilt it on the side and blitz it with the little stick mixer, I'll end up with this beautiful foam which I can spin on. But I want to make a cream-based foam. So I'll take my... Now I've got my lesser than dissolved in a liquid. I'll take my cream, and I'm going to get my air bubbles a different way. I'm going to get my air bubbles by using an NO2 charge. So cream...
And again here, note that we are now using technology to do one thing and one thing only. Instead of having to beat something and everything that goes with that, which may not be what you want, here we simply combine lecithin and then we add air manually, just air. Has everyone seen these before, these EC Whipper siphons? It's like your old cream whipper, only much, much more expensive.
So you can get that if they've got the little red bit on the top of it, it means they can do hot and cold, so it's double wall insulated. So if I was making a cauliflower, I wanted to make a cauliflower foam or a cauliflower mousse to go with a braised piece of short rib and a jus gras, I could do it, put it in there, so make up my puree, make my cauliflower puree, add some lecithin to it, put it in there, charge it, sit it in a water bath so it stays at that temperature, and then as an order comes in, I get my short rib, jus, and that's life of a chef made simple. Cool. Okay, so we now use these to add our air.
So increasing the pressure in there, Ben, he sort of holds it in there for a minute, letting that, or a few seconds at least, letting that pressure incorporate. Letting the pressure force this air, this nitrous oxide, in fact, through the liquid, dissolving it through. And there's a one-way valve, so we can take that off and go again. More pressure, more air dissolved. Then, eventually, when he pulls the trigger, that pressure is released suddenly, the liquid is forced out, those tiny air bubbles that dissolve expand very quickly, and instant foam. Or else.
Yeah, or not. It's always fun working with these nitro guns. You never quite know what's going to happen at this point. One more, I reckon, Joel. Yep.
So part of this is because Ben only had a relatively small amount of liquid in there.
Yes.
People who do your first year physics can try and calculate some air pressure things in your spare time.
Or there's a line on the outside, you can just fill it up to there.
Hence why Ben did the applied science course.
What do you reckon, Joel? Do you reckon we're there?
Go on. Yeah.
So I took three.
Yep.
I did the math in my head, I knew that. That's why I had three there.
Yep, it's a good call.
So we're getting pretty close to being able to plate something up here, mate.
Yep, brilliant. Got to do the fluid.
Fluid gel. So you can see we started out with sort of sugar. You could see the sugar. That's now collapsed and you've actually got a nice amount of liquid in there. So I want to cut the bag open.
And, you know, we're moving towards this final stage of plating up. This is actually a really critical stage. Because to an extent, I mean, everything you taste, if you taste food and you think it tastes good or you think it tastes bad, you're living in the matrix, right? Because food does not, there's no law of physics that says this food tastes good and this food tastes bad. We really like fermented scrapings from the bottom of barrels, Vegemite. In Iceland, they love rotted shark, hakul. This is a great DLC. I actually quite like the rotten shark, but most people don't get much of a crossover. Similarly with wines, if you think that a wine is really good or you think a wine doesn't taste very good, it's all in your head. Now, that's great because if you like something, do it and enjoy it. Just don't think that there is some actual law that says this wine is good and this wine is bad. You know, you put a bad wine in a good bottle, you give it to a wine connoisseur, they will think it's a good wine. I'm not joking, I'm being very serious. Not, you know, there are limits because they have trained themselves to taste that, oh, this amount of acid and this sort of oaky flavour is good. This is sort of the pinnacle of its craft. Just like, you know, when we talk about artists, you know, an impressionist painter, we talk about the pinnacle of that craft. You know, if you take a Jackson Pollock back, they're probably not going to think it's great art. The Eiffel Tower was not popular art when it was created. So psychology is critical. And that means we know that if food looks appetizing, we will literally enjoy it more.
So I've got this, the juice that I've been able to extract from our berries, our sugar, our vanilla, and our star anise. So I just want to add a little bit of ultra text to it. And this is really cold. And you can do that. You can do this with a whiskey if you want to. You still get some clumping. The best way to do it is with that thing there. But the problem is, when you do it, you get air bubbles that form. You've got to leave it for half an hour for those air bubbles to dissipate, and then you can use it. We don't have half an hour.
Sadly.
So I'm going to just whisk it in little by little, and I'm going to pass it again through our sieve to get rid of that clumping and sort of, if I had another sieve, I would sieve it in and mix it as I'm sieving. But
and this clumping, just so we're clear here, isn't the same as clumping
no.
in my ghastly sauce here. This is just simply that the outside, you know, like you know, if you get sand, you know, that magic sand, you know, you put it underwater, you take it out, it's still dry in the middle. A little bit of that happening. So just you need to break apart those clumps of Ultratex.
And that's what your little stick blender will do. But I don't want to have to wait for those air bubbles to dissipate. A touch more. And this is a very inexact science with Ultratex. It's a matter of add a little bit, mix it in, add a little bit, mix it in, until you get the consistency that you want. Because the consistency I want for this, the way I want to plate the dish, is, might be very different to the consistency that you want. You might want to put it into a squirt bottle to be able to pipe little dots of gel on there. I want it to be... You might want it thin so you can get a paintbrush and you can paint on a plate with it.
If Ultratex 4 doesn't do it for you, there's Ultratex 3, Ultratex 8, clear gel, dozens of other similarly modified starches.
Yeah.
And there's something out there that will do what you want. For a price. This is more expensive than cornstarch.
You were saying before, Joel, that you were a good cook. Do you want to turn that pan on?
Yes.
And just get some heat and some caramelization into my bread and butter pudding.
Lovely.
So I baked some bread and butter pudding this morning. It was just really, really good quality sourdough fruit loaf, blitzed up in a food processor. And then I made a custard. I used honey, brown sugar, egg yolks, vanilla, cinnamon, allspice to make my custard base. Mixed my fruit loaf and my custard base together until it was nice and soft. Spread it out in a roasting tray, put it in the oven, sprinkled some raw sugar on top, dolloped some butter and roasted it. And then you end up with bread and butter pudding. It comes out in a slab. You take it out. You can cut it out with a cutter. You can cut it into squares, however you want to do it. You can just break it up and pour cream over the top of it and eat it. It's beautiful. That is done, mate. My fluid gel. Nice. So I'll just pass that to get rid of my these things. I love these little containers. Pass that through a sieve, a fine mesh sieve, and you'll end up with this really beautiful, smooth gel at the end. There we go. So you've got this, that thickness that Joel got with his corn flour before, but I haven't had to heat anything up to get that thickness. So.
And it doesn't look like snot.
Oh, that smells so good. How you going there, mate?
Yeah, starting to get a little bit of brown on the bottom there.
All right,
so a little bit of extra Maillard reaction flavours.
So Maillard reaction, everyone calls it caramelisation. It's not caramelisation, is it?
Not in this context, almost certainly.
So caramelisation is just sugar.
Yep.
Whereas Maillard reaction is proteins, fats, and sugars. And I guess it's an interaction of those things under a certain temperature to give all those beautiful flavours that we want, those roasty, toasty, gorgeous flavours that we get when we cook meat or we toast bread or we bake muffins and things like that.
Yep.
Smelling good.
I think that's probably good to go when you are, Ben, unless you want to do the tops as well. Which way are you going to plate them?
No, I reckon. I reckon that's good to go. Now, this is a cool little ingredient as well. This I didn't make, but it's fun. Isomalt is an inverted sugar, so it means it doesn't react the same way that normal sugar does. And we normally use it if we're making honeycomb in the kitchen, or we're doing sugar work, or we're creating caramel to go on croquembouche or something like that. You don't want it to react with the moisture in the air and go soft. So we use isomalt as a replacement for normal sugar. Now, I don't really understand inverted sugars that well. I know that all I know is that, you're right? Joel, inverted sugars.
So basically, there are a variety of different ways you can make sugar, and what we call inverted sugar, different way of structuring that sugar molecule. And what it does in this context, so sugar is normally very high hygroscopic. It attracts a lot of water. This is why, you know, if you leave sugar out or if you leave, you know, boiled lollies out, they will very quickly start to melt. They absorb sugar quickly. Whereas isomalt, by processing the sugar in a certain way and changing the structure of that molecule, you can hide those bits of the sugar molecule that would typically love water. That's why if you see like sugar sculptures, isomalt is often what they're made out of.
I just want to try that, so I'm just putting something in there to try it. Oh my God. That's so good.
It's all right, I came prepared.
So in the restaurant, we would pop, you could spread all this foam out, put it in the fridge, and then again, as an order comes in, you could get someone a spoon and sort of pop it on there. Or you can do it straight onto the plate if you've got the time. Then, that white chocolate snow on top of that. And these are freeze-dried raspberry pieces, which are coated in isomalt, so they stay crunchy. So that's it. That's...
Look at that. Look at that MasterChef level. Gurin, I think you better come up and judge quickly. You know, what's your verdict? Are we gonna do a taste test, Ben?
Yeah, I'll grab a.
Have you got a taste?
A clean spoon.
Or we could divide it into 300.
Look, that's your call. You're the one on stage with a spoon.
Give me that spoon.
I think Ben's got a professional version there.
What a treat! Thank you. Is this where I tell you I'm lactose intolerant? No. I'm just kidding.
Yes, tell us that.
No, I'm just kidding.
We'll start
here
again.
We go. A little bit of everything.
I'm going to take that as a yes.
I just like this.
So good. So, so good.
Oh.
Well done, guys. That deserves another round.
Thank you.
A gentleman. Yeah. Awesome. Ladies and gentlemen, we've come to the end of this wonderful presentation. I hope you've enjoyed yourselves as much as I have. Now, we'd like to open the floor to some questions. We won't take too long. And there would have been pieces of paper going around. Now, we have the two lovely ladies that if anyone needs, there's a gentleman here in the front that needs a slip of paper. If anyone needs a slip of paper, just raise your hand and put down your questions. Now, in the interest of time and in the interest of our... we have both speakers here today. I'll try and entertain a variety of questions and we'll have a good balance between sciencey questions and I'm sure there are a few of you asking for recipes. But I'm sure Ben will be very happy. Okay, while I wait for the questions to come up, let me tell you a little bit about a few upcoming events. Now, next Wednesday, the 12th of April, we are having the 8th Steve Irwin Memorial Lecture. And if you're interested in joining us for that, please log on to our UQ Science website, or you can probably find all the information you need on UQ Science or follow us on Twitter. So that's the 8th Steve Irwin Memorial Lecture happening next Wednesday evening. The next BrisScience Lecture will take you all the way to Western Australia. And in the Kimberley region of Western Australia, we have a stretch of about 25 kilometres of land, and once upon a time, this was scheduled for a development in liquid and gas mining. We have an associate professor, Steve Salisbury from UQ, who is a paleontologist. Young man, what does a paleontologist do? He studies dinosaurs. That's right. So you get a bite out of this later. Okay, he studies dinosaurs. And Steve is a paleontologist, and his work is in looking at dinosaur tracks in this region and why that is so valuable enough for that development not to go through. And so that's in, we've got some questions, Leonie? Awesome. I'm going to try and spit them up, and Joel will probably help me select some of these questions.
You're far away. This is your job now.
Okay, here is a question. We started off today's session with the cryobags and vacuum bags, some people call it. And the question is, what is the evidence, okay, over the years of its use to show that they are safe and don't contaminate the food? Thanks, Joel.
You look at me, aren't you?
Yeah.
The answer is that it depends. So some plastics do actually leak into food. So we've heard of BPA, possibly. So BPA, a chemical in plastics, which does leak into water and other things, may or may not be harmful to you, but it's probably not a great thing. There are also some very low-grade plastics, like, you know, that really cheap glad wrap you might get in a fruit shop? That doesn't respond to heat very well, so it becomes not stable. These bags that Ben was using, as well as almost every food-grade Ziploc bag you'll get in a supermarket, are heat-stable easily up to the sort of 70, 80-degree mark that we would normally cook at. So the evidence is really, really strong that there is no issues there with that. You know, you can't say never, and if this is a concern for you, then, you know, that's something you should obviously consider, but... I certainly have no issues from a scientific point of view with plastic in this context.
I sort of trust the industry, I guess. It was one of those things that I questioned initially when I first started sort of using the bags, but I've never had an experience where it's changed flavour, you can taste plastic or anything like that, or any adverse reactions from putting the bags into high temperature. The most I would ever take them to normally in the kitchen in the restaurant is 88 degrees. I wouldn't take it above that because that's the cell walls of vegetables break down at sort of 84, 85 degrees. So we don't really need to take it above that. I've never taken it to 100 degrees to see how it handles boiling. And I would never put it in a dry environment. So I'd never put it in the oven. It always goes into a fully submerged either water bath, or we put it in a combi oven and put the atmosphere up to 100 to 100% humidity in the combi and set it to about 88 degrees.
Thank you very much. We have another question, probably for Joel. You talked us through what happens to the molecules as you are slowly bringing your cornstarch water solution, or mixture, I should say, giving some heat to it. But can you tell us what happens to the molecules once that process ends and the sauce is starting to set?
So while it's still hot, there is still some dynamic nature to those bonds. As you stir in particular, you're constantly breaking bonds and new ones are forming. As you cool it down, however, those bonds will start to set in that structure, and depending on which starch you've used, it can either set quite firm, like a gel, it can have 3D structure, or it might only set as more of a thickened liquid or a fluid gel where it will never actually sort of rise up on itself. And this is why, when you're making a sauce, you should typically make it whatever thickness you want it a little bit thinner while it's hot, because as it cools, it will thicken somewhat. If you leave it long enough, then you can actually get a process where the starch molecules will start to crystallize again. This is actually staling. This is what happens in bread, that the starch molecules crystallize and form a rigid structure, which makes stale bread hard.
And the old school way of sort of testing your jams, the old school ways of testing your jams where you put a plate in the freezer, you spoon some onto the plate, and that'll cool it down quickly, and then you can see what it's going to be like once it's cool. So we would do that if we're making a gel which we want to actually stand up on itself, to be able to pipe onto little dots on a plate. We'll, once we get it to the stage where we think it's thick enough, if we're heating it, we'd take a cold plate out, pipe some on there, and see if it actually holds on itself. That's the good thing about Ultratex, is you don't need to wait for it to cool. It's whatever consistency it is, will be the consistency it is.
Awesome. Probably a question for Ben here, and I'm sure all of you are wondering. What do you recommend is the best time to sous vide a steak?
Oh, gee.
How long?
It depends entirely on the steak. So every steak has a different cooking time. If you've got a tomahawk steak, which is the big ribeye, so it's the Scotch fillet that's attached to the bone, then everyone always says medium rare. I would take that to medium, almost sort of medium well, because you've got a marble of fat which is inside the meat, which has to be rendered out. And the more you cook it, the more of that you'll render, and it keeps it nice and moist. But if you've got an eye fillet or a porterhouse or a backstrap of lamb, then medium rare. So generally speaking, with meat, the more connective tissue, the more muscle fibers that run in lots of different directions, the longer that will need to be cooked. The leaner the piece of meat is, the more muscle fibers that run in the same direction, the less that needs to be cooked. So medium rare for really lean cuts of meat, medium well for meat that's got fat in it, because you want to render that fat out. So
of course, noting that with sous vide, if you're doing it like that, you have a little bit more flexibility around your time and temperature.
Yeah, so our eye fillets in the restaurant, a 280 gram portion of eye fillet goes in, a clove of garlic, a knob of butter, a sprig of thyme, some rosemary. We seal it up, it goes into a water bath, set at about 50 degrees, it can sit there all night for 2-3 hours, because it's never going to overcook, and then we don't have to worry about it. So again, depends on the cut, and sous vide gives you that leeway of leaving it for 2 hours, and it's never going to overcook.
Thank you. Now, we can't get through all the questions, we'll just have time for one more, and if those of you who have asked questions, feel free to pop by later and have a chat with Ben or Joel. I'll leave this last question. It's from one of our younger members in the audience. I can tell from the handwriting and spelling. And I'll leave this question with you all. What is your favorite recipe?
My nan's scones. Yeah, which I would make once a week. Yeah, and I love it because my daughter, who's 3 years old, and that is the thing that we do together. My daughter grew up seeing more of me on TV than she'd seen me in real life, because I was traveling so much filming TV shows. So she connects food with me. So we get to cook, and when we get to cook, she loves making scones because she gets her hands in there. But she's learnt all of the really annoying habits that I've got. So she puts salt into food the way I put salt into food. So from a height, and yeah. So she, like, where did you get that from? And if I put fish in front of her, she'll ask for lemon. And so she's picked up all these great little tricks. So she's become a critic of my food at 3 years old.
Awesome. That's wonderful.
So, yeah, my nan scones.
Beautiful. Joel?
Look, for me, I'd have to say it is my buttermilk pancakes because, A, breakfast is my absolute favourite meal of the day. And these pancakes, my partner and I have slaved over for years of experimenting with, you know, finding every recipe for buttermilk pancakes we could, trying out different combinations. We've, you know, tested out, like, how much does it matter how much you mix them or not, cooking them in egg rings or cooking them flat, and eventually narrowing in on this recipe that just gives us these perfect buttermilk pancakes that are absolute to our liking. They are complete, they are, you know, very tender but still moist, wonderful buttermilk flavour.
Mm. How many people are going to ask Joel for the buttermilk pancake recipe now?
And I think it, because for us it was this this triumph of both, you know, cooking, but also the science that we, you know, we spruik to each other. And you know,
it works.
It works, yes, right? We did the scientific method and we made something better.
Science
and we did
works.
It. Yeah. So buttermilk pancakes.
Awesome. Can we give the boys another round?
Nice work.
Thanks, mate.
And just on behalf of the Faculty of Science at the University of Queensland, we would like to express our deepest gratitude in doing this. You've got a whole closet full of these. Hey, Joel.
I think I'd be able to cash in for a car.
Thank you, Ben.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, Gary.
Thank you.
Thanks very much. That was
no worries. Yeah. Now, if you can all join me, we've got some food for you all outside. You must be hungry. Thank you very much for your time. Thanks for coming, and we'll hope to see you at the next BrisScience.